email listeners, go through that one. And we're continuing with the transformation of Saul. And I've got a ton of material tonight, and I won't cover it all, but we'll see how far we can get. And we were looking at how God had taken this killer of Christians, this man named Saul, and via his grace allowed him to see Jesus. And thus he began a journey that has been paralleled by few, if any, in the history of Christianity. And remember, we've taken this incident, the incident on the road to Damascus, and I've divided it into five steps. The first step being the contact, the second step being the conviction, then the conversion, then the consecration, and then the communion. And we were studying under the heading of the contact. We discussed how conversion experiences can differ from dramatic to routine, if there is such a thing as a routine conversion. And we noted that whatever the circumstance, that every time there is contact, it is the result of God's sovereign will. As a side note, we also saw how the last person before Saul to see the resurrected Christ was Stephen. Again, an example of God's grace. A man who was present at the stoning of Stephen is the next man to see the resurrected Christ. And so here we have, friends, we have the fact that salvation begins with a divine sovereign act in the contact. And that is what we would theologically call the doctrine of selection. All right? That's the doctrine of the sovereignty of God in motion as he goes to the sinner. All right, so that closes up the idea of the contact. Let's begin to look at the conviction. Whenever there's going to be salvation, there's got to be conviction of what? Conviction of sin, right? Because why does there have to be conviction of sin? That's the separator between man and God. Sin has to be exposed. In this instance, it is very exposed. At this point, the conviction is so potent that this poor fellow Saul actually begins to shake like a leaf. And we find in verse 4 of chapter 9 of Acts that he then fell to the ground, it says, and he heard a voice saying unto him, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Now Saul was in the perfect position at that point for conversion. He was flat on his face, and he heard the voice of Jesus Christ. And the repeat of his name is interesting. Saul, Saul. When Luke repeats names in his writings, he uses it to indicate a rebuke or a warning. He used it when he spoke about Martha, Martha, Simon, Simon, the city of Jerusalem. He wrote it twice. And here, Saul, Saul. So in Luke's mind, what we have here is a rebuke or a warning, and it is a rebuke or a warning, as we will see. And Christ says to Saul, why are you persecuting me? And you know, I can't read the psychology of the man Saul, but I'll tell you one thing, that would absolutely, you know, do you think that Saul was living with any guilt as he was going about the countryside persecuting Christians? You don't? Is there not built into every man a sense of what is right and what is wrong? Okay. Follow along with me and let's see. Romans 1 tells us that everyone in your outline, the words are right and wrong, has that sense. Now, Paul, or Saul, had been living, I believe, a horrible conflict in his life. Believing he was doing right in persecuting Christians, and yet, because it was wrong, I believe there had to be a tremendous guilt in his life. And later down in verse 5, if you look at what it says, it is hard for you to kick against the goads. A lot of you didn't get last week's outline, and there's actually two outlines back there. One is from last week, which was in the office. It was underneath a book. And there's another outline there for this week. Does anybody need this week's outline? Can somebody get those outlines for me and bring them over, please? You got the right one? Okay. So there's actually 2 weeks' outlines back there. 77. They need 77. So I believe that Saul is living with a conflict in his life. Look at what it says in verse 5. It is hard for you to kick against the goads. Does that indicate a conflict? Yes, doesn't it? It is hard for you to kick against the goads. What Jesus is saying is, this hasn't been easy for you to do. He's been fighting God, and for Saul, fighting God in this sense of persecuting Christians hasn't come easy. So I believe that Paul, or Saul, has been living with a kind of guilt in his life, and I think his conscience must be heavy, and it must have been hard for him to try to exist in the kind of thing he was existing in. Remember, we read that he was breathing, the Greek says breathing in the air of threat and slaughter. And now he hears Jesus talk to him, and he says, "Why are you persecuting me?" When he hears those words, can you imagine what must have run through his mind and his soul as he's confronted with the horrors of what he's been doing? I think since the death of Stephen, Saul has been worried that Christianity is the truth. And I think he's been living a life of lies. And Jesus says, "Why are you doing this? What did I do to you?" If you go back to John 15:25, Jesus says, "They hated me without a cause." After all, how can anybody really hate Jesus when you think about it? And I like another thing here. He says, "Why are you persecuting me? Why are you persecuting me?" Well, he's not persecuting Jesus. He's been persecuting Christians. But if you persecute Christians, who are you persecuting? That's right, because we are inseparably tied to each other. He that is joined to the Lord, it says, is one spirit. You can't persecute Jesus, or you can't persecute a child of Jesus without persecuting Jesus. Every time a blow is hit on earth against a Christian, it is felt in heaven. That's why he's the word describes him as our sympathetic high priest. He is touched with the feelings, it says, of our infirmities. Jesus, the scripture says, bears our griefs. He carries our sorrows. And here he says to Saul, "Why are you persecuting me?" And I think that's the first crack in the light of the doctrine of the body and its head, which Paul will later explain in great detail in the book of Ephesians. This is Saul's first exposure to the inseparability of the life of a Christian and Jesus Christ, their Lord. Because we are one, aren't we? And that's a When you consider you're joined to the creator of the universe, that's a pretty glorious thing. That's a thrilling thing to know that we're bound together as all members of his body. So whatever hurts one of us hurts all of us. Saul was actually then dealing blows to Jesus himself as he persecuted the first century church. Now I want you to notice here what the real issue is, because Saul is hit with the real issue. The real issue in every person's life is what he does with whom? With Jesus Christ. God doesn't say to Saul, "Saul, you've been a bad guy. Saul, you're terrible because you have hate in your heart." He did. He was. "Saul, you're going around murdering people." Yes, he was. But Jesus didn't say that, because that's all superficial to the real problem. He says, "Saul, you know what your problem is? You're persecuting me. That's the problem." And if you're a sinner, and you know, if you're a sinner and you die and go to hell, you won't go to hell because you lied. And you're not going to go to hell because you stole something. I've lied. I've stole stuff. I'm not going to go to hell because I got drunk or because I did drugs and I've done other things. The only way I would go to hell if I didn't acknowledge Jesus Christ as my Lord and as my Savior. That's the only reason anybody will ever go to hell. Because all Christians who may be to the world, even though we may appear to the world sometimes to be holy, we have a lot of other stuff going on in our lives too. You know, we got a lot of flesh in our lives sometimes. Sometimes it's tough. But because we are on the right terms with Christ, because we are positionally in Christ, which means we're saved, our eternal issue is saved. It's already taken care of. So when the Lord talks to Saul and he says, in essence, he says, "Your problem's simple. Why are you persecuting me?" Any man who lives in the world apart from Christ is just as guilty as Saul of rejecting Christ. And my friends, to reject Jesus Christ at any level damns a man eternally. The degree of his damnation is inconsequential. Although we believe in degrees of punishment in hell, the best position in hell is still much worse than any position in heaven. So we say that the real issue of conviction is what a man does with Christ. So when you're sharing Christ with anybody, that's the point you want to get to. What do you believe about Jesus Christ? Are you able to believe that Christ died for you on the cross, died for your sin, died so that you would have an eternity with him? And you know, bless Saul's heart, he learned a good lesson. You see later in his life that he writes all these wonderful things. You know, when you read Paul's letters, you almost forget who he once was, because he was such a mean person. 1 Corinthians 16:22. "If any man love not the Lord Jesus Christ, let him be anathema." What does anathema mean? A curse. Boy, you don't know that. It had to be a joy for Paul to write those words, because he had once been himself a curse. He loved him now, but he didn't love him then. So the issue is what a man does with Jesus. If you don't love Jesus, the scripture says you're accursed. And it's just that simple. So that's the issue behind conviction: unbelief, rebellion towards Jesus Christ. So you see, the Spirit of God, through the preparation of the life of Paul, has brought him now to a crisis. And Christ confronts him and says, "You've got a problem." And remember in John 16:9, Jesus said, He's going to convict the world of sin because they believe not on me, he said. And that's the issue. That's always the central issue whenever we're trying to talk to people about the Lord. All right? So we looked at the contact, and after that, immediately the conviction. And that's the way it should work. Whenever you bring somebody to Christ, you have to talk about them to them about their rebellion against Christ. And really, it's not right that anybody exists on the face of the earth that doesn't give God glory. God deserves his glory. So we've looked at contact, conviction, and now in verse 5, we'll look at conversion. And I think Saul is converted in the white spaces in between the letters in verse 5. Because it doesn't really say much about being converted. But verse 6, by verse 6, he is a different individual. So it has to be somewhere there in verse 5. And he said, and he's not sure to really, he's still kind of figuring out what's going on in his mind. Saul says, "Who are you, Lord?" And the Lord said, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting." So can you imagine the trauma, the emotional and mental trauma, as Saul hears those words? And then he says to him, "It's hard for you to kick against the goads." You see, Jesus recognized the conscience of Saul. He recognized that Saul was feeling guilty. And he says, what he's saying is, doesn't it hurt? Have you thought about kicking against goads? You know what a goad is, right? That's like a long stick with a great big nail stuck on the end of it. And you would use it to move oxen along. And they would poke them in the rear. And it would get them moving, or it would perforate their hide. And to kick against something like that would be terrible. And an ox might resist against that kind of pressure. But for a person to resist, that would be hard to imagine. So Saul, at this point, had been rebelling against God. And who's getting hurt? Is God getting hurt? In fact, ever since Saul had begun persecuting the Christians, what has happened? The church has been spreading exponentially. It has spread faster than it has ever spread before. So the only person that has been getting hurt in the whole process is Saul. So now his conscience has to be ripping him apart. And Jesus said, it's got to be tough doing what you're doing, isn't it? And if you look back at verse 5, as Saul says, "Who are you, Lord?" Notice he's got the right idea in terms of where he belongs in relation to whoever he is speaking to. First of all, he's flat on his face. And secondly, he's already beginning to figure out this is his Lord. And the Lord says, "I'm Jesus." And now I think by then, when Jesus says those words, he knows who he's talking to. He may not yet understand it all, but he knows it's Jesus. When he says, "I am Jesus whom you are persecuting," I think that light goes off in his mind. And he believed. See, Saul, did Saul know a lot about Jesus? Oh, yeah. He was an expert on Jesus. And he had believed that this person was dead. But here this dead person is talking to him. And, you know, Saul had debated Stephen in the synagogues. He had chased Christians and tortured them and questioned them and attempting to get them to deny their faith. He knew all about the gospel from front to back and back to front. And I think when he heard Jesus say, I'm the one that's speaking to you now, I think immediately Saul said, I can't hang with this. I give up. I can't fight this. And that's where I think you see the conversion of this man. He immediately acknowledges Jesus as Messiah and Savior. And the terrible truth had to flash through his mind that Jesus, who had gone about doing good, healing all those oppressed of the devil, healing those that were infirm in many different ways. Jesus, who had been crucified and rejected by his own people, that same Jesus whom Stephen prayed to as he was dying, into whose hands he had committed his spirit, that Jesus whom Saul so hated and whose followers he so mercilessly and cruelly persecuted was in fact alive, and he's who he claims to be, the Messiah. And I believe at that point, bowed as he was in body on his face, I believe his spirit was bowed also as he acknowledged Christ. And all the bloodshed that he had shed drowned in his sorrow, the sorrow of his sins. And I think he was a shattered man. And he was penitent. And he's lying beneath the mercy of God. And his heart is broken by his need for repentance. And I believe at that very moment, Saul was healed by his faith. In your outline, the word is faith. Now, this is a glorious conversion. And you should read some of the stuff that describe the conversion of Saul to make it sound as if it's a farce. I read at least a half dozen different opinions. There's a famous French philosopher named Radan. I was reading what he had to say. He said this: well, it is an uneasy conscience with unstrung nerves, fatigue of the journey, eyes inflamed by the hot sun, and a sudden stroke of fever that produced the hallucination of Saul. Others say, I read that what happened was a thunderstorm in the middle of the desert that just happened to hit at that very moment. And because Saul was so overwrought by the guilt of his own conscience, he just assumed it was God speaking to him, and he imagined the whole thing. And then the most popular view that is espoused in the nation Israel, including a view that is held by many Jewish scholars, is that Paul, was an epileptic. This view is very popular, has been written about by numerous Jewish religious leaders, and they note how the life of Paul, that it was in fact a thorn in his side. And the thing about usually epileptics, when they have seizures, they can't remember anything that happens during the seizure. Paul remembers everything. But let me quote from you. This is from Dr. Klausner, who has a whole book about the life of Saul. And he says this: some epileptics have had great and powerful personalities. And then he lists all these epileptics. I didn't know all these people were epileptics. He says Muhammad, Augustine, Saint Bernard. That poor dog. I don't know. Napoleon I, Julius Caesar, Peter the Great, he says, were all epileptics. And then he continues, you know, it's not too bad to be an epileptic, he writes, because some epileptics have accomplished great things. I don't even know. You know what I would say? I don't know how many of you know Ironside, the commentary in Ironside. He's one of my favorite commentarians, so I always read what he writes about some of these things. Ironside wrote that if Saul's conversion was caused by epilepsy, he said, "Oh, blessed epilepsy." So, you know, you and I know what happened. God invaded the life of Saul on the way to Damascus. And what's hard to understand is that it's harder to believe the things that these people write. It's harder to believe those things than it is to believe the Bible. But people will believe that stuff that's harder to believe than the Bible. Just put your faith in God. I don't see how and why people will go through all those mental gymnastics to come up with these wrong answers. They have to be able to substantiate and validate their darkness. So Saul bows, and I love the fact that he said that Jesus says, "I'm Jesus," because he identifies himself. And at what name will every knee bow? At the name of Jesus. You know who wrote that? Paul. Paul knew what was going on. He was already bowing. So the battle's over here, and I believe he got converted, as I said, in the white spaces in verse 5. And Jesus said to him, "You've been kicking against me. You've been kicking against those goats." And remember in Judges 3, Shamgar, he killed... You want to know how bad a goad is? He kills 600 men with a goad. That's how bad in Judges 3 this guy has a goad, and he kills 600 guys with it. So Paul had been doing a painful thing to himself. He was the only one getting hurt. When you kick against God, I can tell you, you're the one that's going to get hurt. Okay? You can try to throw yourself up against God. Guess what? You're not going to hurt him at all. You're not going to break him. So now I think what happens in Saul's life is that he has a sudden peace that begins to enter his soul, and he begins to rest from the inner battle that he's been fighting. And when Paul rested, you know what? If you look in verse 31 of chapter 9 of Acts, so does everybody else. It says in verse 31 of chapter 9, then the churches, and it says they had peace and were edified. Because Saul had stopped hassling everybody because people were worried about him. Now everybody was able to rest. And I think even if Saul hadn't been converted, if he had just died, the churches would have been able to rest because he was a great persecutor of the church. So we see the contact, the conviction. Christ convicts him of the real issue. And I say that's the issue in your life, my friend. If you don't know Jesus Christ, if you're here tonight and you don't know Christ, that's the issue in your life. I don't care about anything else. I don't care about how good you are or any of that other stuff. That's the issue. And then we came to the conversion. And you've got to think, you know, compare Saul with his contemporaries. Saul was a Pharisee, was he not? And because did the Pharisees hear about Jesus? Did they see his miracles? They spoke to him. They questioned him. They went through all these things. But they responded without faith. Saul responded in faith. They responded in apostasy. Paul responded with an open heart. It took him a while to get there. And he expresses the view of his conversion. 1 Timothy 1:12, he says, "And I thank Christ Jesus, our Lord, who has enabled me, in that he counted me faithful, putting me into the ministry." In other words, he gave him the faith. He counted him faithful. Saul believed, and God saw he was faithful and counted that faithfulness, as he did with Abraham, unto righteousness and placed him in the ministry. And he continues, Paul says about himself that before he was a blasphemer and a persecutor, and he was injurious, it says in the King James, which means he was a great aggressor. But, he says, I obtained mercy. And why was that? He continues, because I did what? He did the things he did, he says, ignorantly in unbelief. Now, if you do things in unbelief, then you cannot be held to apostasy. He says he did it because he didn't fully understand the truth. And those fellow Jews who did understand the truth, because I believe they did, I think they were illuminated with the truth, will spend an eternity in hell unless they finally came to know Christ as the Lord and Savior. Paul continues in Timothy. He writes, "And the grace of our Lord was exceedingly abundant with faith and love, which is in Christ Jesus," he says. God just let down his his grace to drown me. And then he says, this is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, who I am chief. Chief. Nevertheless, he says, that in me first Christ Jesus might show forth a pattern to them that they would believe. Even then, as Paul's writing to Timothy, he speaks to God's long-suffering and forgiving. And so, his entire soul of Saul, which had once had been wrapped in the annihilation of the church, if his plan had succeeded, the church probably would have been smothered, drowned in its own blood. Satan's plan would have worked, but we know that would never happen. But this man with great sin would now not be damned forever because of God's grace and mercy was still available to him. And so, he's converted. Quickly, I'll look at his consecration. And this is good stuff. You know, very often people come to me with problems, and they'll tell me that they've accepted Christ as their Lord and Savior, but their life does not indicate that they've accepted Christ as their Savior. And if you open up, if you're able to crack that nut and open it up, that where you end up getting to is, well, I haven't been able to give that part of my life to him yet. Let me say this about that. Saul was saved and consecrated to his life, to his full-time life service, I believe, at the very same moment. And that's the way I believe God expects it to work. Does it work that way all the time? No. But I believe that's what the Lord expects to happen. Verse 6, notice what it says. So he, trembling and astonished, that's probably putting it mildly, said, what does he say? Lord, what do you want me to do? He's just come to Jesus, and the very first words out of his mouth is, what do you want me to do? With the inference is that I'll do anything, right? That's right. And notice a foothold. This is a footnote. This is a Medeiros footnote. That little phrase I just read, that, you know, that doesn't appear in the manuscript. That little phrase I just read is in chapter 22, verse 10. And the scribe, one of the scribes, as the manuscripts progressed through the years, decided that was a real good thing to put in verse 6. But it's not in the oldest manuscripts. And you might say, well, what's it doing there? Well, it was in 22:10. And like I said, somebody thought it would fit good there. And it's biblical, correct? So in 22:10 is a recounting of the narrative from Paul's own word. So some, you know how men are. We always want to make things better. So he decided to put it there. But the oldest manuscripts don't have that. But it's still a true statement. Came from 22:10. You can look at 22:10 if you want. So we'll take it and add it to the narrative. Amen. I don't know. That's a good question. That's a good question. I don't know. I don't know. So he says, what do you want me to do? And that is consecration. What does consecration mean? To be consecrated. Set apart. Yes, to be set apart for God's service. And he's saying, Lord, what do you want me to do? Here's my life. What do you want out of me? I'll give you everything I have. And I mean, because what did Saul have left? He didn't have a lot left. His previous career was kind of down the tube. So he says, I'll give you everything I have, my whole career, and I'll start from here with nothing, and I'll do anything you wanted me to. And I love the idea that he said, Lord, what do you want me to do? That's good. Because in that one verse, you know, this is a deal with me. He recognizes the lordship of Jesus Christ. And again, I hear people say it all the time. I hear people say it in counseling. I know he's my Savior, but I haven't been able to accept him fully as my Lord. Oh, man. The problem with that thought process is it's not biblical. It's not accurate. If you don't receive him as Lord, is Jesus Lord? Does he need you to receive him to be Lord? Jesus is Lord. It doesn't matter how you want it or not, he is Lord. So when you receive him as your Savior, he comes to you as your Lord. He doesn't come, he don't get to, oh, let me have a little bit of Jesus here and a little bit of this Jesus here and a little bit of that. Oh, I don't want that Jesus. I don't want that Lordship Jesus. Because then I got to give up the things I don't want to give up. You know, I had somebody walk up to me after a sermon one Sunday and tell me, I want you to know I was saved 10 years ago, but today I made Jesus the Lord of my life. I was amazed. I still haven't figured that out. You don't make Jesus the Lord. He is Lord. In your outline, the words are Lord and Lord. If you didn't do one thing, if you don't make him Lord, it doesn't matter. He's still Lord. Your position on that matter is immaterial. And you can go all through the New Testament, and you'll find verse after verse. John 13:13, in the upper room, Jesus is talking, and he says, you call me Lord, you do well, for I am. Okay? I am. The only question is, the question is not, who am I? The question is, how obedient are you? The question in the Christian life, the real Christian life is not, is he Lord of your life? The question for the real Christian is, are you obeying the Lord of your life? That's the question. And Saul says from the very beginning of his life, these first words he utters, he's recognizing him as his Lord. And he's saying, in essence, I'm going to obey you. And that's what the Christian life is a battle. The Christian life is a battle. And I'll close here in a second. Listen, this is, if you don't get anything else, get this one thing. The Christian life is a battle between the will of Jesus Christ and the will of the Christian. Okay? And you know what the best definition of a mature Christian is when your will and God's will always agree. Okay? A mature Christian. That's the process of a Christian becoming mature in the Lord. Here's God's will. Okay? Here's your will. You're saved. And you begin to grow and grow. What do we call this? Sanctification. And you begin to grow and you become more mature. And as you become more and more mature, those wills get closer and closer together. And then you find out that finding the will of God in your life isn't such a big problem. The problem for Christians who never give in, that they struggle with, what is God's will for my life? And because they struggle, there's no confirmation. There's no being conformed to the image of Christ. And so they stay right where they are, and they become stagnant, and they become frustrated, and sometimes they become bitter, and they leave the church, and they blame God for their problems. Jesus is Lord. All you can find verse after verse after verse. Okay? That's enough.